Yeah. And please, do you hear me today? Please report if you hear me.
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay, great, great. Okay, so let's start our lecture. Let me share my screen and we will proceed right away. So I believe we're in a good shape and we are a little bit even ahead of schedule, which is good. So I recall your homework. Homework is due this Friday. Homework number 6, and on Wednesday and Thursday, as usual, we will have help sessions. And what I intend to do, in the meantime, I intend to post another homework. It will be homework number 7. You will see it now on my screen. We did not negotiate it yet with Dr. Hedrick, so I'll delay a little bit, but it will be posted soon. And why I want to post it earlier, because it will be just 1 week after homework number 6. It will be due April 16th. And again, you will have help sessions on next Wednesday and Thursday. Why we call it homework 7A? Because then it will be 7B, because we have chapter 7. It's a big chapter, entropy. We split it into homeworks. One will be here and one will be after your exam number 3. Right. And another thing that I intend to give you one more quiz, and I believe we will do it on Wednesday, because as I told you, I'm really not happy with your exam 2. You need some points, so that will be chance for you to get extra points. And the quiz, if it's on this Wednesday, it will be based on both exam 2 and 3. It will be based on chapter 4, 5, and 6, and 7 that we are just starting today. So that it is. Also, some people ask a little question, so you can chart if you have any particular questions. But regarding homework 6, I know a couple of questions that I want to address before we proceed. So if you talk about homework 6, key point, I think we discussed examples and people, I addressed some questions. The key point here to understand if you deal with power cycle or we deal with refrigeration or heat pump cycle. And for instance, in problem 8, if you see problem 8, it's understandable, it's heat pump cycle when work is deposited into it, and it's coefficient of performance in 3. But some people ask me, what about problem number 7? When is it like heat engine or heat pump? Well, the answer is the following, that please read the text, and as long as you talk about COP, and especially if this COP is larger than 1, definitely you talk about fridge or heat pump cycle. Please understand that when you convert heat into work, efficiency, thermal efficiency cannot exceed 1, right? In fact, it's less than 1. There is Carnot maximal efficiency. So it definitely cannot be larger than 1. You cannot generate more energy that you deposited here. But we are lucky when we talk about heat pump or heat engine, as you see on the screen, your coefficient of performance can be larger. So if it's 2.8, it's definitely fridge or heat pump cycle. And please understand that, like, you are lucky here. We're always lucky to have fridge or heat pump because you can deliver more energy that you deposit. So what does it mean that your COP is 2.8? It means that you deposit, you take a power of 1 kilowatt, you deposit 1 kilowatt of electricity, but you deposit 2.8 upstairs or 3.8, whatever it is. It's larger, right? It's like when you have some donation, people say that somebody will match. When you donate dollars, somebody donate one more dollar. Here, somebody, the nature donate $2.8 per each dollar you donate, right? So it's very effective way to transfer heat. That's why we prefer, we like to have these heat pumps. Does it make sense? And here, well, I want to discuss, last time I discussed the example, let's discuss it in more detail. This very good example from your textbook and is similar to you having your problems. It's example 6.7. So please take a look. So let me go again through it briefly. So what we have here, we have a heat pump to which heats your house. This is your heat pump. You have at the street, you have minus 10 degrees Celsius. And in the in-house, you have 21 degrees Celsius. You keep these temperatures. So that it is. And basically, it's stated that your heat pump keeps your house hot. So what does it mean? It means that it's compensate heat losses. It's stated here that heat losses go at 135 megajoules per hour. So what does it mean? It means that your QH here that you see, if you annotate, that QH is this value, right? This is your QH. And the question is, please determine minimal power required for this heat pump. Here is it. So how to calculate it and what we are doing here? So basically, key point here is the following. So you should be able to write down that coefficient of performance of your heat pump, or you can call it gamma, right? It's coefficient of performance for a heat pump. It's what? It will be nothing but QH. QH dot, because you talk about rates, divided by what? By work input. Correct? Work input. So that is the value. So now take a look. What do we know here? What we don't know? Do we know QH? Yes, we know QH. And by the way, key point here, please may be able to convert it kilojoule per kilogram into kilowatt, because what is hour? It's 3,600 hours. So that is what, if you calculate here, it's nothing but 1,000 kilojoules, right? Divided by 3,600 seconds. We need to switch to seconds to get kilowatt. And this gives you what? Here it is. It gives you, don't forget to convert, it gives you 37.5 kilowatt. So you know it. Okay, great. So you know QH. Here it is. This is your QH. Okay. But what else do you know? Do you know anything else? It looks like you don't know. Again, you need at least two items to know. But reads here, it stated determine the minimum power required. Key point here, it's minimum. Because you know which heat pump provides minimum input. The best heat pump, right? How we call it? Carnot heat pump, reversible heat pump. So it means that your gamma is what? It corresponds to gamma minimal. Gamma, actually, minimal power input corresponds to gamma maximal. Gamma maximal, or let's say gamma reversible, right? And what is gamma reversible? We know the formula, it will be QH, right? So now, will you calculate it? Yeah, key point, remember, switch from Celsius to Kelvin. Because if you don't switch, this value will be negative. Or this value can be less than one, because you can get everything you want, right? Because if TL is negative, imagine what I have here. It's impossible. So please definitely switch it, and you realize it's here and here, right? So because this value will give you what? It will be like 294 Kelvin, approximately, of course. And this gain value will be 268 Kelvin, right? 268 Kelvin. So when you calculate it, you will know that your gamma is something like 11.3. So when you know coefficient of performance, what you can do, then you can calculate your work input. You calculate your work input, which gives you this value. Does it make sense? And again, please take a look here and realize how good to have heat pump. So this heat pump is hypothetical. It does not exist in practice, of course, but if it would exist, it's really, its coefficient of performance would be really perfect, 11.13. So please realize what happens here. Your heat pump consumes 332 kilowatt from power source, but it delivers 37.5 into your room. Does it make sense? So for each kilowatt that you pay, you get 11.3 kilowatt, which comes into your room, and they come for free. Do you understand? You pay for this, but this nature gives you this, which is 11.3 times more. You pay $1 and somebody give you $10.3 for free. So together you have in your pocket 11.3. Does it make sense? Any question about this? I believe not. Okay, great. Then, if it's so, let's proceed with next chapter. So let's start eventually chapter 7. And I will also open this. Chapter 6. And then chapter 7, part A. Chapter 7, part A. And we will discuss something. So what happens now? Let me say like this. We are start talking about entropy now. About entropy, it's new concept. It will be difficult concept for many of you. And by believe or not, we just 4 weeks left until the end of semester, right? And I'm almost until the end of semester, except for last week, we will be talking about entropy. So your task now, and remember just in 2 weeks from now, On April 19th, we will have exam number 3. So please, your key assignment by that time is to understand entropy, and you should be dealing with entropy like you do with other items like energy, volume, enthalpy, and so on. Okay. So that's your objective. So we will investigate entropy, entropy increase principles, and how entropy works with various devices. So to start with, so remember second law of thermodynamics. So far, I told you we have 3 alternative statements, and you already know very well, I do believe you know Kelvin-Planck statement, which tells you that you must have second reservoir for a power cycle. And you know Clausius statement, right? Which tells you that your fridge may work, but it may not work for free. You cannot transfer heat directly from cold to hot source without power input. And there is entropy statement, which simply says that it is impossible for any system to operate in such a manner that entropy is destroyed. So before we go in, remember, we don't say that entropy cannot decrease. It may decrease. Entropy cannot be destroyed. Entropy is something that can be generated from nothing, but it cannot be destroyed. And now the question is, okay, what is entropy? What we are talking about? And I will give like 4 definitions of entropy that I want you to understand and realize. We'll be talking about. So to come to it, let's do the following. So I recall a so-called analytical form of Kelvin-Planck statement. What it was? It states that work over the cycle is non-positive. It can be negative or 0. And when it's 0? It's 0 when in the system there are no irreversibility, so when you can go clockwise and counterclockwise in both directions. But if you go and face some irreversibilities, your work will become negative because your irreversibilities consume your work, and you cannot go backward because if you would go backward, what is less than 0 will become positive, right? Remember, integral taken clockwise and counterclockwise have opposite signs. So if you go counterclockwise, your minus become plus, which is impossible. That is. Why do I say this? Because now I can derive something that we call Clausius inequality. Don't confuse it with Clausius integral and Clausius statement. In thermodynamics, you know, there are not too many people deal with it. So there are two different items related to the same name. There is Carnot cycle and Carnot principle. There is Clausius integral, Clausius statement, the Clausius inequality. So please don't confuse them, please. So let's say like this. Let's say I have reversible, internally reversible cycle. And you know that what it does. So let's say I have thermal reservoir here. I have hot of heat here, source of heat here. Some heat goes here and it's converted into work. And of course, by Kelvin-Planck statement, you know that you must have some heat rejection here. You say you have another reservoir. And let's say instead of another reservoir, I have another system there, which converts heat into work. And now let me see how combined system works. So what you see here, I can write like this. What I wrote here, it's just what? It's just first law, which I wrote, the delta E is dQ minus W. Okay? I don't request you to remember derivations, but I request you to understand how it comes from. So now, since my reversible cycle here is reversible, I can write like this. Remember what I did here. It's just how people introduce Kelvin scale, that Q is proportional to Q. So what will happen here if I substitute this into here? I will have the following. And now let me ask you, what will happen if I now take this equation and integrate it over the cycle? Let me just integrate it over the cycle. What will happen if I integrate it over the cycle? If I integrate like over the cycle, like this, and like this, what will happen? This will go out, this will go out, right? Because this is zero. And what remains, it's only what I see here. It will be like this. Now, what about this value? What can you say about sine of this value? If you look here, what is this? From the previous slide, we know that this is non-positive, right? This is like this. And what do we know about temperature? Its temperature is in Kelvin scale, so it's again, it's positive. It cannot be zero, it can be negative, correct? So what can I get from here? I will get that dQ over T, right? Internal reversible. Okay, it's internally reversible. And this value, what it will be less from here. It will be what? I can write it like this. It will be what? It will be work okay. And since work here is non-positive and T is positive, it will be what? It will be non-positive. It's like this. So what I derive here, it's what we call Clausius inequality. Does it make sense? Now, why do I call it inequality in brackets? Because at some point it becomes equality. Remember, if I have internally reversible process, if there are no irreversibilities inside the system, then work is zero and it becomes equality. Does it make sense? Please ask me something. If it makes sense, then what? Then why we need it? Because then I can introduce what? I tell you, this is general form of Clausius inequality, that's this value. So I'm interested in this item, dQ over T. So I can introduce now a new function, which in such a manner, so I say that let me introduce new function S in such a manner that its differential between along the internal reversible process will be like this. So let's say I have dQ over T and I have internal reversible process. So I will introduce function which differential is given by this. Okay, can I do it? Yes. And now I will call this function will be named entropy, such that if you integrate it, change of entropy between two states, it will be this integral. So by dimensions, it will be the same like heat capacity in kilojoule per Kelvin, it will be heat over temperature. If you take it per unit mass, it will be kilojoule per kilogram Kelvin, like CP or CV, but it's not specific heat. It's a conceptually different item. We'll talk more about this. So does it make sense? So that formula gives you a definition of entropy. Do you understand this? Does it make sense for you? Okay, that is entropy. That's how we define it. That's how we define it. Now, let's forget about entropy for about 5-10 minutes. We will come back to it. And let's discuss more about Clausius inequality. Because this Clausius inequality allows you to do the following. It allows you to get another way to quantify second law. I will show you. So in addition to Clausius inequality, there is a concept of Clausius integral. So that's how we introduce it. So we introduce this value, we can call it like sigma over that sigma over the cycle will be introduced like conventionally like this. It will be integral over dQ over T. When you take it across the boundary, Okay. With sine, why sine minus? It's conventional sign that happens because we want this be to measure to have the same dimensions at entropy, and we want it to be positive. So that's how we introduce it. That's what we call Clausius, Clausius integral. So B, it is taken over the boundary. It's not taken through the system, and it's taken over the cycle. So why we introduce it like this? Because now you may realize that it's another way to quantify, but based on the sigma, it's another way to quantify second law. Because what is this sigma is? It's just, it, you realize now that it will be measured in units of entropy, and it will be measure of irreversibilities. So if I go through the cycle, and what happens? If I go through the cycle and I don't face any reversibility, what does it mean that sigma is zero? It means that I don't face any irreversibility. So it's my system is ideal. I walk through it freely. I did not destroy anything, so I don't pay any penalty. Does it make sense? So that means that your system is reversible and theoretically possible. Now, what happens in practice, of course, when you go through the cycle, you do destroy something. You do dissipate some work. So it means that there are irreversibilities, and your sigma quantity is the measure of your irreversibilities, right? Now, if sigma is less than zero, it means that it's impossible because you, what would it mean? It would mean that you destroy entropy. It would mean that you get bonus for walking through it, which is impossible. And what I call talk about sigma here is the same for entropy. Now, please understand, I know it's difficult. So I want, we approach the same subject in different manners. So please understand, please listen to me, what I'm talking. What I say here, let me illustrate it like this. Imagine that you are driving, and police officer stop you and ask you something. What most likely it means? It means that you violated something and you are here. It means that most likely you will get some penalty ticket or at least some warning, right? So it means that something like you drive, you are happy, you do nothing bad, but you got this ticket and you cannot get rid of it. Now it's in your hand and you're unhappy anymore, but that happens. You got it. It was this entropy was generated from nothing. Now, may it happen that police officer just stop you and say that, you know, you're a brilliant driver. I really appreciate how you drive. Well, I don't believe they spend time on this, but theoretically this is possible, which would actually mean what? Which would mean that you are here. That police officer says this, you didn't violate anything. I just want to say this to you. Well, theoretically it's possible. Then you don't get ticket. You get zero ticket, right? But can you imagine the situation that police officer stop you and say that, you know, you are so good driver that I give you bonus ticket. Now you can go twice on red light. Do we believe in this? I don't believe. This is impossible. You cannot be here. You, unlike my course, you don't get bonus tickets for good driving. You get just penalty tickets. So we are here. It means that this is impossible. It's impossible that you destroy entropy. It's impossible that you have negative irreversibilities which give you some bonuses. So this is impossible. Do you understand this? Does it help you to understand the topic? Hopefully. So why do I talk about this? Because now I will show you something. Read this textbook, read this example. Remember we solved it last time. Remember this problem? Remember we did it last time or pre-last time, or last Wednesday? So how we did it? To address this, let me open it. Where was it? Yeah, here was it. Remember how we solved this problem. So you had, I recall it's the same problem. You had hot reservoir at 500 degrees Kelvin, and you had cold reservoir, which with variable, with flexible temperature, which can be 200, 300, or 400 Kelvin. You get 1,000 kilojoules from hot reservoir, part is converted into work, and 600 is rejected here. And the question was, please determine the nature of the cycle. So is it reversible or irreversible, possible or impossible. And remember how we quantify it. It's your homework six, right? What you do, what typically do. What you did. You first, you calculate your performance, you calculate your maximal performance, and then you compare them, right? And make a conclusion. If you less than maximal, you're okay. If you equal to maximal, it's theoretically possible. If you exceed maximal, you're not okay. It means that something goes wrong. You're lying, it's impossible. That's what we did. So you calculate actual performance here, that what happened. It happens where, and then you check what happened with your temperature. So when your TL is 200 Kelvin, that's what I have here, you have that your eta maximal is 0.6. It exceeds your eta, which means that it's possible and irreversible. Everybody understand what's going on. Everybody can solve this problem now. Please don't delay if not, because later it will be harder and harder. If instead of 200 Kelvin, my TL is 300 Kelvin, what I got? I got that my maximal efficiency will be the same as my efficiency, which drive me to conclusion that it's theoretically possible and reversible. Eventually, if my maximal efficiency is this, I make a conclusion that it's impossible because maximal efficiency cannot be less than my actual efficiency. It means that if I say this, my actual efficiency is wrong. It cannot happen. I cannot exceed maximal efficiency. Do you remember and understand this? Now we will do exactly the same problem, but based on Clausius inequality, Clausius integral. Let's do it. So again, what I'm here, I call this as a problem. So what we'll do? We will calculate sigma, and then we will compare the sigma to zero and make our conclusion. If sigma is positive, it's okay. It means that you generated some, because sigma is a measure of irreversibilities. So if your sigma is positive, okay, that's possible and irreversible because there are irreversibilities. If sigma is zero, it's theoretically possible and reversible. If sigma is negative, it's impossible, right? That it is. So that's what we will do. We will calculate sigma and do it. So remember what we have here. What is our QH and all this stuff, right? So basically, I can draw it again. So what we have? We have like this, right? Here you have TH, which is 500 Kelvin. Here you have TL, which will be different, which will be 200 or 300 or 400 Kelvin. Here you have your heat engine. Here you have your Q in, which is QH. Which is what? It's 1,000 kilojoules. And here you have Q out. Which is what? Which is 600 kilojoules. Correct? So that's what we have. So if I consider case A, if my TL is 200 Kelvin, what I have? I will calculate that my sigma is 1 kilojoule per Kelvin. Well, quantity is here does not matter. The sign plays a role. So I will calculate that it's positive. So what is my conclusion? My conclusion is that it's the same conclusion that when eta is less than eta maximal, it means that I have irreversibilities. Sigma is measure of irreversibility. So irreversibility is present with the system. So this is possible and irreversible. But what happens if instead of 200 Kelvin, my TL is 300 Kelvin, right? What I will have if I have 300 Kelvin? Then I will get that my sigma is zero. Do we see it? What does it mean that sigma is zero? It means that there are no irreversibilities in my system. It means that it's reversible, and it means that my eta is equal to eta maximal. And if you will do counterparts with previous scenarios, what does it mean? That here I have that eta is less than eta maximal. Here I have that eta is equal to eta maximal. Now, if last case, if I have the TL is 400 Kelvin, it means that my sigma is what? My sigma is negative, which is impossible. Because this would actually mean what? This would mean that eta is larger maximum, that eta maximum. Do you understand what is happening? The same cases, three cases, and we check. It's which way to use to solve the problem? Up to you, both ways are okay. And while you do homework 6, actually there is a recommendation for you, try to solve the problems in the same manner twice with these two methods and make sure you get the same answer. It's a good practice for you. Agree? Please do it. So, and yeah, one more point what I want to say. So here I get value minus 0.5 kilojoule per kilogram. Please understand that if I arrived here to conclusion with value minus 1000 kilojoule per Kelvin, or if I have here minus 0.0001, the answer would be still the same. This value is still less than zero and it's impossible. Whatever small it is, you cannot violate second law anyhow. You cannot be half pregnant or half dead, or you cannot be 0.01 chance pregnant or 0.01 dead, right? You are either is yes or yes or not. You are alive or not. So this is impossible. It does not matter how big it is, it's impossible. Does it make sense? Any question here? Okay, then come back to entropy. And so you will realize now that, remember how we define it. You define entropy, so I want to talk more about entropy. And basically what we did, we define entropy in such a manner that we say that if you have state one and state two, that entropy is a function inside which change between state two and state one. It's what? It's integral, not circle integral, just integral over value dq over t through internally reversible process. Okay? That's how we define it. So it looks like when you define it like this, it's a function of the path. But I will show you now that not exactly. I will show you now that it's still a property, it's a function of state. So let's say like this. Let's say I have two cycles, AC and BC. So I go from state one to state two through trajectory A and then through trajectory C. And also I can go through trajectory B and then through trajectory C. And let's say we talk about internal reversible processes. Then what? I can write the following. Here is my sigma over cycle. If I talk about internal reversible processes, what does it mean? That my sigma should be zero, right? So what I wrote here, if I go first through trajectory A and then trajectory C, my sigma is zero, right? And I have like this. But then if I go through trajectory B and then through trajectory C, it's also zero here. So please take a look here. So this is zero, this is zero. So they are equal and they are equal. So what remains? Remains this and remains this. Do you agree that they are equal from here? I believe so. So what does it mean? It means that these values are the same. So what does it mean? That this quantity does not depend on trajectory. When I go through trajectory A or when I go through trajectory B, these quantities are the same. And that is what? It means that your entropy change between state one and state two does not depend on trajectory. It depends on what? It will be S2 minus S1. It means that entropy, it's a property, right? Even we just talk about it on reversible process, yes, it means that entropy, it's a property, depends on state. And it will mean that now it does not matter, do you have reversible or irreversible process? Entropy will not care about it. Entropy will just depend on the state. This is a formula. Okay, so now we will get about, I will give you some summaries about entropy, but I want you to understand the following. We have four approaches to entropy, and let's discuss this approach. So what is it? What we can talk about? So what do we know about entropy? Like one approach to entropy is what? You know it maybe from school, from general principle of life. People say that entropy is a measure of order or disorder. Yes? You know it. People say to you that it's a measure of order or disorder. Sorry, it disappeared here. Correct. You know that if some process is more entropic, if you have increased temperature, your system becomes more chaotic, it's more entropic. If you pressurize your system, it becomes more order, it's less entropic. Right? Now, what else do we know? I just intergive it to you. We have formulas. Let's put S here, formulas. Correct? We have formulas. Like in the previous page, we introduced formulas, right? It's integral over dq over t. I know it's not easy to use it yet, but still. Now, later you will see that when you look at your tables, remember your property tables. In your property tables, there is one more. Remember your property tables, right? So if you look at your property tables, there are what substance we have here? We have V, U, and H. We have specific volume. You have specific internal energy. You have specific enthalpy, right? So there is one more item there, S, which is called entropy, something that you deal with. So let me place it like this. What's happening here? Well, this different computer, it's not very nice to work, but anyway. So I will say that item tables from your property tables, right? And also remember, remember how I told you about second law. I tell you that nature does not want you to transfer heat from cold to hot source or convert heat into work. I told you this. So I told you nature does not want this. So nature actually says that second law tells you that you should pay penalty if you do it, right? And currency in which you pay your penalty is called entropy. So I will write it like this. I will write in quotes because it's my personal interpretation, right? Currency to pay penalty. Okay. So, and now you may realize that it's four different approaches, right? Absolutely four different approaches, but we talk about the same item and all of them are entropy and it's the same. And you should understand that entropy is the same. All these four approaches are okay with it. And somehow you will have to deal with it. You will be should be able to deal with entropy among all these four approaches. So what is this? Entropy will be another extensive property. It's a property, it's a function of state, not a process. It's extensive property. So it means that if you divide system by two, entropy will be divided, it's additive value. It will be in your tables, it will be specific entropy, right? So like we had to deal with mass and energy, it will be balance equation for entropy. And entropy can penetrate through the boundaries of the system, right? Like mass and energy. So due to heat, due to work, due to mass transfer, you can bring entropy with you. But there will be some conceptual difference that there is no conservation of entropy, okay? There is no conservation of entropy. Entropy can be generated from nothing. Like I told you, penalty ticket, it appeared. It will be source of entropy. That makes difference. It's extensive property. And what also I want you to realize, sometimes people don't realize it, please look here, that entropy change in the system, entropy change can be positive or negative. Please don't say that entropy always increase. It's only for isolated system like our universe, entropy increase. Entropy may decrease. It happens often when entropy decrease. So when you have state one and state two, it can be positive or negative, please realize it. And again, units for entropy like kilojoule per Kelvin, for specific entropy, kilojoule per Kelvin kilogram, like for specific heat. Now, at this point, we will arrive to what we call entropy increase principle. And that's formulation of second. So let's say like this. So please look at this picture. So let's say I have state one and state two. And when I go from state one to state two, it's like any process. It can be reversible or irreversible. But when I go back from two to one, it will be internally reversible. By the way, in your book and in the slides, I keep the same convention. I don't like it because it's stated here that like your real process are shown by dashed line, because irreversible is actually a real process. So your true processes are shown by dashed lines, while your internally reversible will be shown by solid line. In practice, typically in geometry, it's vice versa, right? We show imaginary processes by dashed and real by solid. Here it's vice versa. But let's keep this convention. So now let's do something. So let's see what you see here. This is your Clausius inequality, right? Here is your Clausius inequality. And how I can express it, Clausius inequality. Let's say first I go from state one to state two and then back. So I have this plus this, okay? Now take a look here. What is this? What is this quantity? You agree that it's nothing but S1, minus S2, S1 minus S2, because we go from two to one, not S2 minus one. It's delta S to one, okay? So then what? Then I arrive like this, and from here I will get that S2 minus S1, which is delta S, it will be like this. I can write that my delta S like this. Do you agree? What is it? Why I talk about? Look here. We say here that delta S exceeds something. So I can write, or in differential form like this. So I can write the delta S is like this. Now let me say like this. What does it mean that you exceed something? What does it mean that like this? Now I talk about trivial things in terms of mathematics, but non-trivial in terms of physics. What does it mean larger or equal? What does it mean that I'm elder than you? It means that I'm you plus something which is not negative, correct? What does it mean that I exceed you? It means that S2 minus S1, it will be what? It is this quantity plus something, okay? And this something is non-negative, okay? So let me call this something. So I can write that it's equal to this integral plus something. Let me call this something entropy generation. And then this value, what I can say here, this value is non-negative. Agree? Please look at this. It's very important formula here. It's we say here that entropy change between state one and state two, it's what? It's this integral plus entropy generation. Okay. Now, why it's important? Let's say I have internally reversible process. Then what? Then this value will be zero by default. And this value will be internally reversible. And it will be definition of entropy as it should be. Correct? But if it's not internally reversible, then this value is not zero. And I have this expression, I still can talk about entropy. Correct? That it is. So it is entropy generation, which is non-negative. Entropy generation. Please understand. So now you may realize that second law, entropy increase principle, how it look like. Remember what we stated. It does not state that entropy cannot grow or decrease. It stated it's impossible for any system to operate in a manner that entropy is destroyed. So entropy generation cannot be negative. It's a penalty. Your penalty ticket cannot be bonus ticket. Entropy generation cannot be negative. It's zero or positive. That's what we say here. But entropy change can be either positive or zero or negative. Please realize. If entropy generation is positive, it means that it's really what you've talked about and it's an irreversible process, it's realistic. If entropy generation is zero, then it's reversible. It's theoretically possible. If entropy generation is negative, it's impossible. And now I want you to explain that entropy can decrease over system. This is classical example what happened. You have a closed system here. Let's say I have tank of water, okay? And I put this tank of water into a fridge. What will happen with this water? It will get frozen. What happened with entropy of water? It will decrease. It's okay because this is not isolated system because there is heat transfer from it. So fridge will freeze it. So entropy of water when it becomes ice will decrease. But your fridge consumes electricity. So your fridge will generate more entropy. Then you decrease it. So entropy of your system decrease, but entropy of fridge increase. And total entropy generation of the system will be positive. Total entropy generation, I mean of fridge plus water. Do you understand? So entropy of my system decrease, but entropy of the nature of the universe increased. Another example, let's have an open system. Let's have I take it, I drink cup of tea. What happened with entropy of this cup when I drink it, when it's drunk? Well, I have empty cup. Definitely its entropy is less than before. But this tea now is in my stomach and there are chemical processes in my stomach to utilize it. So my stomach will generate more entropy that I took out from this cup. So entropy generation will be positive because it's not very easy to generate tea back from my stomach, right? It's not straightforward. Do you understand this? You can steal money, but you cannot print money. The same example, like keep talking about police officers that stop you and give you ticket. You have it, you cannot get rid of it. What you can do? You can give it to your friend and your friend will pay it instead of you, but you cannot destroy it. And all your trials to destroy this ticket will be against you. What you can do to destroy it? Well, you destroy your ticket, what you can do? Potentially you can neglect this ticket, but then you will get another ticket with more penalty. You can try to give a bribe to police officer, or you can kill police officer, right? What will happen? Most likely you will end up with a jail and with much more criminal stories than just for driving, and your license will be suspended. So all your trials to remove it will produce more and more crime. The same story here. Your trials to reduce entropy will produce more entropy. When I freeze my water in the fridge, I will produce more entropy. Even entropy inside the tank will go out. Does this make sense for you? And remember, so that's what I want you to realize, that entropy can be generated from nothing. And entropy cannot be destroyed. There is no conservation of entropy, but there is balance equation of entropy. And entropy is one more item from your table. Like, remember in your table, you have V, U, H, S. So you should be deal with your entropy like you deal with everything else, like you deal with V, U, H, S. So you should be able to deal with it, right? And whatever we discuss, all these TV, PV, TS diagrams, it will be the same for entropy, for S. Don't confuse enthalpy and entropy. It's different item. And everything we discussed, it will be still the same here. Does it make sense? We will talk about, keep talking about this. And in, on Wednesday, I intend to give you quiz, optional quiz on Wednesday at next lecture, because I wasn't happy with your exam. I want to give you bonus points. So please be in Zoom and be prepared. The quiz will be based on chapters 4, 5, and 6 and part of chapter 7 that we just started. But overall, still the same requirements. On Friday, we will have our lecture. And please proceed as it should be. Please, you should be able to manage to deal with entropy like you deal with all other items. I know it will be difficult for some time, but when you manage it, it will be everything self-consistent. Please realize it, okay? Okay, so I will stop at this point. Be ready for a quiz, and I will stop recording. On this, and see you on Wednesday. If you have any questions, please let's discuss it.